This week, it's stupidity, self-fulfilling prophecy, and an EVALI conspiracy theory that brings out the rage sweat. I'm DJ Alex, and this is your Hunky Vape Global 20 Vaping News Science and Advocacy Report for the 30th of July, 2021. This week's lead story comes from Michelle Minton at the Competitive Enterprise Institute. As she points out, tobacco control's latest self-fulfilling prophecy. Fact is, most Americans have probably never heard of heated tobacco products, let alone understand the concept of heat not burn for harm reduction. And until the EVALI scare, the majority of smokers never heard about vaping as we know it. Sure, they might have known about Cigalikes or Blue or Juuls, but the only way they would know about a real vape with a mod, a tank, and bottles of e-liquid is if a fellow smoker quit smoking with a real vape. In the U.S., it is illegal for vape shops and tobacco companies to advertise their products to the public. And for those locations where it isn't completely illegal, it is so restrictive that it might as well be. Why isn't a vape shop allowed to tell their customers about the 10,000 scientific studies proving how much safer vaping is than smoking? Or how much more effective vaping is to quit smoking than nicotine replacement therapy? The cards are stacked against harm reduction products. And it's all because of legislation enacted by tobacco control groups and its unwavering minion of hypocritical do-gooders. So it's no surprise that this week, Bloomberg and his henchmen at the World Health Organization propagated more lies to keep people smoking longer. This isn't a singular occurrence in one country. It happens all around the world. And the part that brings out the most rage sweat is that these organizations, which claim to be fighting tobacco control for the kids, are using kids in their marketing. I'd show you more, but if I did, this would be the last video from this channel because YouTube would insta-ban Hunky Vape for having children promoting vaping. But it's okay for tobacco control groups to use kids with a vape to promote how cool it is and to promote how delicious the flavors are. Ain't nothing to it but to get into it. Last week, I apparently ruffled some feathers by reporting that Philip Morris International wants to unsmoke the world and stop UK cigarette sales in the next decade. Well, this week, British American Tobacco says, hold on a minute. Yeah, we need to explore beyond nicotine, but to stop selling cigarettes in a country would only mean a thriving black market, just like there was in South Africa during the emergency COVID tobacco ban. Taking a look at their website, it's obvious British American Tobacco is focused on a better tomorrow through science and innovation. But looking at the headlines, what we find out is that cigarette alternatives are exactly what their customers want. And a vaping shift is eventually going to happen. So, like any good business, they're going to face this existential crisis the same way Philip Morris International is. Switching to cannabis and vaping. Non-cigarette sales already grew to 12.5%, and this tobacco giant knows cannabis is part of their future. Here's a report from Bulgaria admitting to the future, and here's another one from the Czech Republic stating the exact same thing. It's becoming obvious tobacco companies are placing combustion on hospice care and ordering a tombstone for cigarette smoking. None of this should come as a surprise to you because ever since the Master Settlement Agreement in 1998, Big Tobacco stopped fighting legislation and instead embraced it as a way for them to be the only viable sellers of these products. A perfect example of this is U.S. Senate Bill 2445, a bill to apply user fees to all tobacco products. And it's going to be known as the Resources to Prevent Youth Vaping Act. Care to guess who is sponsoring this bill? Ms. Shaheen, Ms. Murkowski, Mr. Durbin, Ms. Collins, Ms. Baldwin, and Mr. Romney, a.k.a. the Tobacco Anti-Vaping Crew, hypocritically fighting vaping for their tobacco oligarch benefactors. These 70-something-year-old senators were born during or right after World War II and have been in office since I was in grade school. How are these people still in office? Well, they're bought and paid for, just like how Michael Bloomberg buys politicians.
Gave the Congress the ability to control this president. I bought, I got them.
Well, now that the global e-cigarette market is expected to reach $24.6 billion a year by 2027, or $60 billion by 2025, depending on who you believe, there is no doubt that the companies with the deepest pockets are going to determine who gets to still sell vaping products to us and who's got to die along the way. Here's a list of just some of the companies selling vaping products. Recognize any names here? British American Tobacco, eLeaf, Generation V, Imperial Brands, Inokin Technology, Japan Tobacco, Juul Labs, PMI/Altria, Shenzhen IVPS, Smoker Friendly, Vapor for Life. And this list is not all-inclusive, so obviously there are many others. Did you know that there are 30 lobbyists for each and every elected representative? To buy the politicians that millions of Americans think they elected into office. And if your politician isn't corrupt or won't succumb to the schmoozing that goes on in Washington, then these PR agencies will simply spread outlandish stories in the media to blackmail these representatives into seeing it their way. Doesn't matter if that representative is a Democrat or a Republican, big money interests have them by the balls. And I'm not even going to get into the revolving door where former lobbyists work as top aides in Congress and then vice versa when they leave. Now let me ask you this question. Who on this list has enough money to craft legislation that we all know is going to be coming down the pipeline in the very near future? Who's going to put their money where their mouth is? And even if they do, will it be enough to guarantee them a seat at the table 10 years down the road? It's easy to tell people to fuck off when your head is buried in the sand. But when you put all the chips on the table and see the unsurmountable capital some of these players have, the best you can hope for here is a royal flush from the UK, partnered with China Tobacco, who still owns 44% of the global tobacco market. Moving on to Singapore, because there is simply too much stupid to unpack this week. Filming your kids vape for TikTok? Another fine moment in parenting made its way around the globe in a 14-second video by user A Channeler. It didn't take long for this video to be reported to the Ministry of Social and Family Development, who then had the video taken down within an hour of it going viral. Parents of these kids can now look forward to a $14,700 fine and up to a year in jail for their stupidity. And while we're talking about stupidity, might as well get to this week's public service announcement. If you crash your car and safely get out without injuries, please, for the love of everything that is holy, don't post a picture on Reddit of how your vape survived the car crash. These two posts were on Reddit yesterday after the users crashed and then immediately went looking for their vape. Yes, I understand how proud we are of our devices, especially after a horrific accident that totaled your vehicle. But to then post a pic of the carnage just to say how tough your device is might not be the smartest thing for harm reduction imagery. Stick with a traditional hand check, or show off a cool light in your tank, or show the amazing flavor potential of your coil setup, not kids or crashes. Please and thank you. Moving on to Washington, D.C. and its foolish flavored tobacco ban. This flavor ban won't improve health outcomes, but it will increase overcriminalization. Mayor Muriel Bowser signed into law a ban of the sale of all flavored tobacco products in the District of Columbia. And this article once again reminds people of the consequences of prohibition. Despite the illegality of producing, importing, transporting, and selling alcohol during prohibition, people continued to drink. find new, innovative ways to skirt the law. And the safety of alcohol decreased because of prohibition. Alcohol prohibition came with a slew of unintended repercussions, ranging from the rise of illicit markets to the very real dangers of overcriminalization. We shouldn't expect anything less from the prohibition of tobacco products. How quickly people forget about the mafia and the rackets that they undertook to become the biggest families controlling the black market goods that they sold. Genovese, Gambino, Bonanno, Colombo, Lucchesi families all controlled the black market trade across the entire nation. From the rackets, the gangland wards, the rat's nest, all of these families came to power because of prohibition. And it's just a matter of time before once again we get to see Hollywood blockbusters play out in our own neighborhoods. I'm sure most of you have seen Beverly Hills Cop, where Eddie Murphy played an undercover detective looking to bust an illegal cigarette trafficking operation by trading counterfeit credit cards for a truck full of cigarettes. And we all know what happened next when the police chased the tandem trailers filled with cigarette cartons throughout the neighborhoods. Well, it's no surprise that these Hollywood chase scenes and these lessons learned from history may once again be playing out by prohibitionists getting their way. It's simply a matter of economics. And once again, truck hijackings will become a featured news story where you live. The exorbitant taxes and illegal status of tobacco products artificially drive up the price. And it's not uncommon for tractor trailer to contain a wholesale value of $300,000. When considering the standard 20% face value for stolen goods, this translates to a whopping $60,000 payday for a would-be criminal. It's simply supply and demand economics. Moving on to Canada for even more stupidity. Last week we talked about Canada's nicotine cap and their potential flavor ban. Well, this week, Surrey Now leader reports Delta fire hazard rating raised to extreme as continued hot and dry weather has resulted in tinder dry conditions throughout the Delta. For those of you not familiar with the area, we're talking about Vancouver, Canada, bordering Seattle, Washington in the United States. Regardless, the stupidity is revealed when you look at their banned activities. Smoking or vaping is banned in all parks, trails, and natural lands. Hello! Vaping is not smoking. Vaping does not involve combustion and cannot start a fire unless you remove all the liquid and dry burn cotton with a high-powered mod set at its absolute maximum output. Like I did a couple weeks ago in the news. But, hypocritically, residents are allowed to use approved briquette and propane barbecues. New York Times and FX expand partnership by ordering additional documentaries under the New York Times presence banner. The eighth film from a series called Move Fast, Vape Things is a documentary about e-cigarette company Juul and is scheduled to premiere in September on FX and Hulu. It's going to draw on the investigative work by the Times to reveal how the Silicon Valley darling lost its way and is now accused of introducing a new scourge to youth vaping. Need I remind you that the global youth vaping rate is 0.5%? And even in the United States, daily use of vaping by teenagers is less than 1%. So it's obvious kids are trying vapes because of all the publicity made by tobacco control groups, but they're not getting addicted like they would be if they were smoking. So much stupidity this week. Well, the next story comes from Germany, where Deutschland Fund reports health researchers at the University of Queensland are calling for stronger regulation of the display of e-cigarettes on the video platform TikTok. Researchers analyzed 800 videos with a trillion views and determined 63% of them depicted vaping as positive, and 24% of them were neutral. So doing some math, we find only 13% of the videos were a negative portrayal of vaping. They further guesstimate that a fourth of the videos were of underage vaping. So, since the World Health Organization warned of this tobacco epidemic, Australia needs stronger regulations for TikTok. Meanwhile, vaping could replace cigarettes in Australia within 15 years, predicts Marlboro maker. I told you, Philip Morris wants to unsmoke the world. It's a perfect marketing strategy to promote heat not burn, so Philip Morris International can double its profit margins. United Arab Emirates vaping industry warns of health risks from fake vaping products, increasing as the growth of smoking alternatives provides opportunity for bootleggers. The market for vaping products, liquid and e-cigarettes, is booming in the UAE after a black market industry was brought into the mainstream by regulators in April 2019. Mandatory regulation set by the Emiratus Authority for Standardization boosted the uptake of less harmful alternatives to conventional smoking. But with smoking still considerably cheaper than vaping, tobacco remains the drug of choice for many smokers in the UAE. While this is slowly beginning to change, an emerging counterfeit market is forcing retailers to warn against choosing cheaper fake vaping products. The counterfeit market has very low standards and ethics, so they don't really care about people's health or selling to minors. They are only interested in maximum profit, and as soon as a new popular brand becomes available in a region, there will be counterfeits made. Genuine products are made in regulated environments using certified ingredients and components. Medical-grade nicotine is used in legitimate products, while cheaper alternatives might not be as safe. The article then mentions Dubai is scheduled to host the region's largest vaping expo in September. Another international vaping expo, Vape Italy, is scheduled for October 2nd and 3rd. And both of these expos will be featuring the latest products from all the popular manufacturers in the vaping industry. There's links in the description below if you're interested. Moving on to more stupid, as Governor Paulus and his Colorado health chief says she didn't grasp the problem that led to the huge HIV program cuts. And yes, it involves another vaping scandal in Colorado. You remember some months back when I reported Governor Paulus got his hands caught in the cookie jar with Proposition EE wording to benefit big tobacco? Well, now his health chief got caught using an HIV slush fund on the side to pay for curb teen vaping shadow operations. How much did they divert from HIV programs? How about $500,000 in funding for an anti-vaping program aimed at LGBTQ youth? And no, this isn't some conspiracy theory. The Attorney General is also wrapped up in this investigation. If you want a conspiracy theory, I need to show you some science first. E-cigarette or vaping product use associated lung injury, aka EVALI, is masquerading as COVID-19. Published in the BMJ from the British Medical Association, and regarded as the leading medical research news and educational outlet from the world's oldest medical journal, we find out that the global pandemic, responsible for over 4 million deaths, may be masquerading as EVALI cases. Or in other words, EVALI cases may have been the first cases of COVID in the United States. This study even looked at disease progression through x-rays to analyze and compare both progressions, as well as looking at the outcomes and follow-up of these cases. But without adequate PCR testing, EVALI and COVID may be indistinguishable. Okay. So a rational person would simply take this scientific paper and say, all right, there might be a few cases of EVALI that were misdiagnosed COVID-19 patients. Well, here's where the conspiracy tinfoil hat comes into play. In July 2019, an unexplained fatal pneumonia developed at two nursing homes near Fort Detrick. In September, the state of Maryland, Fort Du Bois, reported the presence of e-cigarette pneumonia, and at the same time, West Virginia, Virginia, and Wisconsin started growing EVALI cases. Meanwhile, Fort Detrick was shut down by the state for not having adequate wastewater treatment. And now Chinese and U.S. conspiracy theorists are crying foul on Fort Detrick and the Wuhan labs. This is a massive rabbit hole. With U.S. patents to Dr. Fauci spending $191 billion taxpayer dollars of function research, and even crimes against humanity lawsuits. But all of these conspiracy theories ignored the damage EVALI has done to tobacco harm reduction progress and the vaping industry itself. Is EVALI a smokescreen for the origins of COVID? Or is it simply a coincidence that both EVALI and COVID cases originated at the same time? That's for you to decide, because I have more science published by the Vapor Herald. UK study, ethnic minorities less likely to use vapes to quit smoking. This research study evaluated population data covering 40 years from 1978 to 2017 and found that people with reduced socioeconomic status more likely to smoke and less likely to quit. A cross-sectional analysis also revealed Asian, Arab, and various other ethnic cultures in the UK were less likely to use e-cigarettes as a way to quit smoking. The study also found similar patterns among native Australians. Moving on to New Zealand, where the Otago Daily Times reports, University of Otago researchers found giving up smoking through vaping is complex. More like common quit milestones such as being smoke-free after 12 weeks should be outdated and replaced after learning of these findings. The study is a descriptive analysis of transition from smoking to ENDS using a daily diary investigative method. 45 participants were provided a vape if they agreed to complete daily surveys over 18 to 20 weeks using a smartphone app. The data collected was then sunburst plotted to see when the participants smoked, when they dual used, when they vaped, or when they didn't smoke or vape. Then the data was sequence plotted to reveal the exact same information. Many of these participants dual used initially, but then switched to vaping completely, or quit altogether as time went on. What became abundantly clear was that unique patterns exist, and no two quitters were identical. More importantly, the researchers found that smoking cessation programs that use common milestones are outdated and proven as ineffective. Each person must transition to the next step only when they are ready and committed to the stop smoking effort. Moving on. You know, originally I wasn't going to cover this Dear Labor story, but after seeing the Aotearoa Vapors Community Advocacy Sign Petition Now advertisement, I figured maybe it was a sign for me to teach everyone how unregulated markets always end up with three or less cartels running the show. The Daily Blog article begs Jacinda Ardern to realize history is calling on her to create a state-owned supermarket. The lie of neoliberalism is that unregulated markets lead to competitive utopia. They don't. They lead to an elite corporate oligarchy who ensures their dominance via duopoly or monopoly. A plutocratic cartel who amputates monopoly rentals from the economy and then calls it business. This is all in response to the Commerce Commission's draft report into competition in the supermarket sector of New Zealand. It found that competition was not working for consumers or the producers of food in New Zealand. When companies put profits above people, the people will always suffer. And this article begs for the brutal strength of the state to step in and break up the food cartel raking in $500 million every year, while 5 million people overpay for a basic human need. How is this food cartel creating so much misery in New Zealand? By using bullying tactics against critics and suppliers. COVID taught us food security matters, and a supermarket chain that embeds a cheaper food security while supporting local suppliers is an absolute necessity to fix the present situation. Instead of boasting about having enough food to feed 40 million worldwide, maybe we should feed the 5 million that live in New Zealand first. People are growing hungry as almost 40% of New Zealand households experience food security, and 19% of children suffer from it every day. Poverty researcher Dr. Rebecca Graham, while working on her thesis on food insecurity, interviewed a woman who walked 90 minutes every day to get a free community meal. New Zealand has 190,000 kids in poverty, over 22,000 on emergency housing lists, growing inequality, and a climate crisis with no real solutions. Don't you think we need to be a little kinder to individuals and crueler to corporations? You're wondering, what's the root of this problem in New Zealand, right? A supermarket superboss of foodstuffs is using heavy-handedness to ensure high profits by forcing suppliers into bankruptcy. New World store owner even bragged about breaking people using the Walmart strategy. Push people until they break and then come back from there. That's exactly what super giants like Walmarts do. They buy up all the products made by a manufacturer, and then they force them to sell the next shipment for even less than the original agreed price. And this behavior continues until one day the producer of the goods can no longer sell it any cheaper. And then the corporate buyer just gets up and walks away, leaving the supplier with a warehouse full of products with nobody left to buy them. Amazon is doing the same thing on a global scale. And it's just a matter of time before these oligarch retailers drive everyone into the poorhouse. Well, unless somebody shakes things up with a totally new way of doing things, kinda like how Zyne is the next Juul. There's a new high-tech nicotine delivery system sweeping the nation. This one could be easier for the public to, swallow. No, don't swallow these pouches. The tobacco industry is innovating faster than governments can regulate. No easy feat in San Francisco, who's already banned indoor smoking, flavored tobacco, and all but banned vaping. Whew, along comes Swedish Match, the maker of Swedish Snus, who's now selling the most popular brand of nicotine pouch to fill the void by these draconian laws. San Francisco banned almost all forms of tobacco, so here comes Zyne Pouches to fill consumers' demand for nicotine. It contains all the nicotine and none of the banned things. No flavor, no combustion, no electronic, no clouds, but plenty of pure lab-grown non-tobacco nicotine for its customers. And store owners are jumping at the chance to carry this pure high nicotine product. This is what too much stupid tobacco control results in. Almost as much stupid as in this new program titled RISE to Combat Substance Abuse. RISE stands for Resources, Inspirations, Strategies, and Education. And Coalition Engagement Specialist Martha Polonsky says they're forming a group of community leaders and everyday citizens to make the greatest possible impact. What are these stupid Puritans trying to do? They're taking a different approach from the norm, so they say. RISE will focus on youth substance abuse to hopefully prevent a younger generation from becoming reliant on drugs and alcohol in the future. You know, these Puritans aren't doing anything new. They try to indoctrinate children and hope that they just don't end up addicted to anything. Let me guess. This is Just Say No 2.0. The World Vapors Alliance launches Back Vaping Beat Smoking campaign to try saving 19 million lives in Europe. With the Beating Cancer Committee meeting in the European Parliament, this graffiti truck aims to draw their attention to the opportunity that they have to make history simply by backing vaping to quit smoking. The message is clear: choose science and save lives. This mural truck will also be shown at key locations around Brussels, including Parliament, the European Commission, the Atomium, and the Palace of Justice, before visiting cities all around Europe, hoping to encourage vapers and politicians to stand up and take action. 2021 is a critical year for vaping, and bringing the message right to EU's front door lets policymakers understand 19 million lives are on the line. The best way we can beat smoking is to promote vaping as a part of our public health policies all around the globe. Well, that wraps up the Global 20 Vaping News Science and Advocacy Report for the week ending July 30th, 2021. Please go become an advocate and fight for your right to vape. I appreciate every single one of you for watching this weekly Vaping News Science and Advocacy Report. Until next week, be good to each other and keep on vaping.